Good evening, First Baptist Church. We want to welcome all of our members and friends and family members near and far. We want to thank you for linking in on another Thursday night Bible study. We have been talking about the end times, and we hope that you are enjoying this discussion about the signs of the time, because we ought to rejoice. Because Jesus Christ is coming back to take over this crazy world in which we live in. His kingdom is going to crush all kingdoms. And so therefore, we thank God that we see these signs. It's not a time for us to get panicky and afraid, but a time for us to rejoice and carry out the will of God that he is calling us to do. Having said that, let us pray. Father God, we thank you for this time together. We thank you for your grace and your mercy. We thank you, Lord, for all that you have done for us and through us. And we pray you continue to bless us and watch over us and help strengthen our hands and our feet, and our eyes and our tongue, Lord, so that we can continue to witness, Lord, for you, Lord, that your return is near. And we pray, Father, that all of those who are under the sound of my weak voice, whatever they stand in need of, we pray, Father, that you would meet their needs. We pray, Father, if it's deliverance, deliver them. If it's encouragement, encourage them. Whatever the need may be, we know, Father, that you can supply all of our needs. And so we just want to thank you going forward, Lord, that you have supplied our needs. Thank you, Father, for a roof over our heads, for food on our table. We just thank you, Father, for clothes on our backs and all of the amenities that we have. Lord, there's so many people that don't even have these things. There's so many people escaping from their countries to try to come here to America and may have to be outdoors all night long. And so, Father, we want to thank you, Lord, for as well as it is. And Father, help us not to forget how blessed we are. Help us, Father, in our efforts, Lord, to glorify your name. And Lord, we thank you. Remember the sick among us. Remember the bereaved among us. Remember, Lord, those who are calling upon your name. We ask, Father, that you continue to embrace us. We ask that you continue to watch over us and forgive us, Lord, for any sinful infractions that we may have committed, knowingly or unknowingly. These and all blessings we ask in our Son Jesus' name, and the people of God said, amen. Amen.
I thought you'd like to know, although life can taste the floor, Brittany and I would make it home all right. Believe in God that he would someday save my soul. Oh, maybe. And I thought you'd like to know. Oh, mama, I want you to know I love you. Please forgive me all the times I broke your heart. Every tear you cried for me drew me closer to being free. I thank you, and I thought you liked to know. I thought you liked to know all those prayers you prayed for me. Never ever one fell to the ground. I know sometimes it looked like I was a million miles from grace. God answered your prayer, and I thought you liked to know. Oh, mama, I want you to know I love you. Please forgive me for all the times I broke your heart. Every tear you cried for me drew me closer to being free. I love you, and I thank you for the know. Thought you liked to know if I could live my life again. If I could, I'd surely make amends. new life. To the scholar, oh, I will. And I thought you liked to know.
Thanks, Sister Walker, for that beautiful mother's song. Mother, how much we love you, and to forgive us if anything we've done. What a beautiful Mother's Day song. Thank you, Sister Walker, for reminding us that this coming Sunday, in fact, all this weekend is Mother's Day, but to be honest with you, Mother's Day is every day. Amen, amen. So we want to thank, Sister Walker, for reminding us of that Mother's Day. We want to continue our Bible study lesson tonight on the end times, and we want to be able to point out some things that Jesus pointed out so that we can be prepared at any time for his return. And as we have been talking, how do we know the return of Jesus Christ is near? We know that because of the things that were pointed out in scripture. There were certain events that the Bible pointed out for us to pay attention to, and those things are happening right now in real time. Our introduction, we're gonna go to our introduction, and we want to read our introduction so you can understand what we are talking about. Are we living in the midst of the signs of the return of Jesus Christ? The answer is a resounding yes. What the scriptures mentioned centuries ago is happening in real time before us. We do well to pay attention to the signs and remain faithful and obedient to the teachings of the gospel of Jesus Christ and his apostles. Before Jesus Christ returns a second time, prophets spoke about what would be occurring before Jesus Christ returns. What would be the moral condition of the world before the return of Jesus Christ? Everything we see in our nation and around the world has been prophesied to happen. And as crazy as things are in our world, we should rejoice because our Lord's coming is near. You say, well, Pastor, how can you rejoice in a world like this? Well, you rejoice in a world like this because, again, we know our Lord is coming. And he's going to change all of that that's going on in our world. He's going to change all this just to have the return of Christ. Can you imagine Christ coming to rule the whole world? No more oppression, no more racism, no more corruption, no more wickedness, no more police brutality, no more inflation. All of the things that causes us grief, all of the things that causes us sorrow, all of the things that keeps us on the edge, those things will be over. So this is why we should rejoice. So we don't know the exact time of Christ's return. In fact, nobody knows, not even some of the modern day prophets like D. Nostradamus. He had predicted when the end of the time is, but he really does not know because Jesus says that nobody knows. And Jesus says, but concerning that day or hour, no one knows, not even the angels of heaven, nor the Son, but the Father only. So we see in this scripture that not even Jesus knows. He said, but only the Father knows. So that is a day that only God knows. Okay, only God knows. According to scripture, this is what Jesus says, that not nor the Son, but only the Father. So only God the Father knows the end, the exact end days and the exact end hour or minute. So therefore, we should not delay in doing his will, because he just may come when we least expect it. And we can find that out in Matthew 24, 42 through 44. Knowing the signs of the time should help us to be effective witnesses to those who don't know Jesus Christ and who are skeptical about his return to take over the world. Jesus says, now learn this lesson from the fig tree. As soon as its figs get tender and its leaves come out, you know that summer is near. In other words, when you see these things that are happening, you know that his coming is near. So therefore, again, rejoice, saints of God, rejoice. This is not a time to be sad. This is not a time to be walking around in melancholy. This is not a time. This is the time to rejoice, because our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, that has been taking care of us, blessing us, forgiving us, doing for us, going before us, coming behind us, healing us, doing all manner of things for us, he is coming, and we're going to see him as he is. So we should rejoice. Now, the world won't rejoice, but we should rejoice of his coming, okay? So because our Lord's coming draws near. Our Lord coming draws near. His kingdom draws near. And can you imagine? And this is the ultimate goal of your life and my life, is to do what? Is to live within God's kingdom. No more crying, no more dying, no more heartaches, no more of the things that vexed us, no more of the things that troubled us. For the wicked shall cease from troubling, and the weary shall be at rest. Can you imagine that kind of world? I can't, because I was born and you were born in times of trouble. You were born in times of killings, in times of man's inhumanity to man. So we were all born at a time when humanity was continuing to be just like unrepentant, unredeemed humanity as they are doing today. But it's going to come a time that Jesus is coming and he is going to rule the world. He is coming to rule the world. Thank God, when he finally gets here, it's just going to blow our minds. It's going to be radically different, because I don't know of a time when you and I have ever lived in a world of perfect peace, a world where everyone got along. It's always, and that's only because Satan, the devil, the enemy of our souls, is always operating to make sure that he divides, that he kills, and he destroys. But there can come a time where he won't be able to do that anymore. So we're going to go ahead and get again into our scriptures, so that we can expound on this lesson even further. All right, our scriptures. And Deacon Lestine Anderson is going to start us off with Jeremiah 23:7-8.
Verse 7. Therefore, behold, the day are coming, said the Lord, and they shall no longer say, as the Lord lives, who brought up the children of Israel from the land of Egypt, but as the Lord liveth, who brought up and led the descendants of the house of Israel from the north country and from all the countries where I have driven them, and they shall deliver in their own land.
Amen. Thank you.
I'm sorry.
No, that's
the last part I couldn't see.
Thank you for reading this scripture for us. We know that this scripture has been fulfilled. Well, how you say that, Pastor? Because notice what the words say here. Therefore, behold, the days are coming, says the Lord, that they shall no longer, as the Lord lives, who say, as the Lord lives, who brought up the children of Israel from the land of Egypt. But as the Lord lives, who brought up and led the descendants of the house of Israel from the north country and from all of the countries that where I had driven them. Now we know there was one time when Israel was so rebellious. Israel was so hard-headed. Israel was so contrary in obeying God. God decided he would scatter them all over the world, on every continent of this planet Earth. God scattered the children of Israel. But then he said, there's gonna come a time, and this is Jeremiah prophesying, there's gonna come a time when they shall dwell in their own land. Well, guess what? Israel now is dwelling in their own land. Ever since 1948, when it was declared that Israel is now a state, they have been dwelling in their own land since 1948. And right beside them, you have the Palestinian. You have the Israelis and you have the Palestinian. And sometimes they are kin people, first cousins and all that, but they are always totally in conflict with one another. But I wanted to lift up the scripture so you can understand that even the prophets spoke of a time when God's people will dwell in their own land. Well, they are in their own land. They are considered a state. They have their own sovereignty documents. They have their own military. They are just like any other nation. And so that prophecy has been fulfilled. So we know that since 1948, they have been declared a state. And so therefore, whatever happens, whatever the scriptures tell us they're gonna happen in the future, we know that this scripture has already been fulfilled because the prophet Jeremiah, said that there will come a time when they will be in their own land, and they are, all right? So we know that that's part of looking at and understanding that Christ is near, because those things that the prophet said would happen, they must happen before Christ returns a second time. And being in their own land is one of those things among other prophetic sayings. All right, let's move to our next scripture. And the next scripture will be read by Reverend Juanita Graham, Matthew 24, 3 through 14.
Good evening. Now, as he sat on the Mount of Olives, the disciples came to him privately saying, "Tell us, when will these things be? And what will be the sign of your coming and of the end of the age?" And Jesus answered and said to them, "Take heed that no one deceives you. For many will come in my name, saying, 'I am the Christ,' and will deceive many. And you will hear of wars and rumors of wars. See that you are not troubled, for all these things must come to pass, but the end is not yet. For nation will rise against nation and kingdom against kingdom, and there will be famines, pestilence, and earthquakes in various places. All these are the beginning of sorrows. Then they will deliver you up to tribulation and kill you, and you will be hated by all nations for my name's sake. And then many will be offended, will be betrayed one another, and will hate one another. Then many false prophets will rise up and deceive many. And because lawlessness will abound, the love of many will grow cold. But he who endures to the end shall be saved. And this gospel of the kingdom will be preached in all the world as a witness to all the nations, and then the end will come."
Amen. Thank you for reading these scriptures for us. This is when Jesus was on the Mount of Olives, and his disciples, they wanted to know, because whatever the conversation was, they didn't quite get it. And they came to Jesus, and they wanted to know, "Now tell us, when these things gonna be. What signs should we see to know that the end of the age is near? What should we look out for? And Jesus answered and said to them, take heed, no one deceives you. Many will come in my name saying, I am the Christ, and will deceive many. So there are many people who, even as I speak, are coming to say that they are the promised one. They are the anointed one. They are the one who God has sent. And Jesus says, they're going to deceive many. And the question I have is, how is it that they can deceive many? It's because the many don't know God's word. The many don't know prophecy. The many probably are not connected to a Bible-believing, Bible-teaching church. So if you're not connected to a Bible-believing, Bible-teaching church, you can be deceived, because people will come, many people. He said, many will come. It don't just have to be a man. It could be a woman. We just don't know. He said, he didn't talk about gender. He said, for many will come in my name, mm-hmm. saying I am the Christ, and will deceive many. So a lot of people going to be deceived. And then he says, and we already know this, you're going to hear wars and rumors of wars. Mm-hmm. You know, we've been having wars after wars after wars. And do you know that wars have increased? I think I was just reading earlier today that way back in the First World War, the First and Second World War, in just 90 years, I want y'all to think about that. In 90 years, those two wars have killed more human beings than all other wars. Think about that. Millions upon millions of people have been killed in just 90 years. Mm. And even now, we have the war between Russia and Ukraine. Mm-hmm. Even now, you're talking about China going into Taiwan. Even now. So we're hearing how conflict is increasing. Mm-hmm. And you will hear wars and rumors of war. Conflict is going to increase. But he said, see that you're not troubled. Don't let this bother you. Don't let this stress you out. Don't let this cause you to lose sleep. He said, for all these things must come to pass. So understand this. There's nothing we can do about it, because what? It must come to pass. So we can't stop what's coming to pass. But what we can do in the midst of what's coming to pass, in the midst of what is passing, we can be obedient to God. We can share the gospel of Jesus Christ. We can lead people into the kingdom. We can let our light shine. There are a number of things that we can do while these things are coming to pass. Some we're in the midst of it passing. Some are to come to pass. But whatever it is, Jesus is saying, don't lose any sleep. Don't get stressed out about it, because it's coming to pass. So don't start praying to me to stop it, because it's not going to stop. It must. He said, for these things must come to pass. They must happen. So that means must mean it's definite. It will. It has to take place. But in the midst, in the have and must take place, you and I must continue to do our job. You and I must continue to allow our light to shine. You and I must continue to be obedient to what he's calling us to do. But he said now, but when these things are coming and passing and to come, but the end is not yet. So out of all of the things that we are witnessing, out of all of the things that we are hearing, out of all the things we see on Facebook and TikTok and all that kind of stuff, he said, but the end is not yet. So you think it's bad now, it's going to get worse. But he's already told you, don't let it trouble you. For nation will rise against nation, and kingdom against kingdom. And there will be famines. We've already gone through pestilence. We've already gone through COVID-19. That's pestilence. I taught a Bible study on that. Those things are going to keep happening. They're going to keep reoccurring. And then you're going to continue to have what? Earthquakes in various places. And then he says, now, when the world undergoes all this, when you witness all this, when you hear about all this, when all of this violence and inhumanity that's going on in and around you, in our nation and around the world, he says that these things are the beginning of sorrows. Mm-hmm. Think about what COVID-19 has done. I think I read where over 1 million people in America died because of COVID. Mothers, fathers, grandparents. It causes unspeakable sorrow, mm-hmm. unspeakable grief. You know, and 7 million worldwide. That's pestilence. Earthquakes. Look what happens in China and other places. Earthquakes, they're happening in real time right before us. And that's not all. He said, that's just the beginning. Then he says, they're going to deliver you up to tribulation and kill you. Uh-oh, maybe I should go and hang up my Christian walk now because I don't want nobody to kill me. Well, Jesus is saying this. Now, whether you are one of the ones or not, I don't know. But he was saying that many who follow him, okay, then they will deliver you up to tribulation. They're going to carry you through something and then kill you. And you will be hated by all nations for my name's sake, just because you have made Jesus Christ your Lord and Savior, just because you call his name, just because you are a follower, and just because you preach and teach about his kingdom, people are going to hate you. And the sad part is that we call ourselves a Christian nation, but do you know there are folk in our Christian nation that hate you just because you're a follower of Jesus Christ? Don't be fooled by labels. I tell people all the time, labels can lie. But it's your life. It's the spirit that you have. It's the light that you let shine before people. And then it says, and then many will be offended. And not only will they be offended, they're going to betray one another. And then they're going to do what? They're going to hate one another. And then many false prophets will rise up and deceive many. We got false prophets among us right now. This is getting ready to happen for you. God getting ready to take you in this year. You're going to have doors opening for you. If all of that's going to happen, let it happen. If God is going to do it, God is going to do it. Not because a person says, it's because God is going to do it because God knows how to do it. But it's a whole lot of stuff that's going on that people tap into. And if you don't watch it, you know, because all of us love good news. All of us are looking for a change. All of us are looking for a promotion. All of us looking for whatever our desires are. We are looking, and somebody can come along and tell us all these things, and there we go. We go to running. But we have to be careful, because just because somebody said it is not going to happen in that time or in that month or during that year. That's God's timing. But he says that many false prophets will rise up and deceive many. And because lawlessness will abound. Now, y'all need to underscore lawlessness, because we have lawlessness going on in our nation every day from Washington, D.C. on down into our districts. Lawlessness. There's so much stuff going on that is so grievous, that is so ungodly. I'd be saying to myself, how can people allow such stuff to get in their heads? I was just telling my wife earlier how people can do things and they think it's a joke. They can put stuff in the food and cakes and all that kind. They think it's a joke when people are eating it, giving it to children. They think lawlessness. They have no regard for the law. They create their own laws. And create their own laws. They think that they can do whatever they want to do and get by with it. That's what you call lawlessness. And so when people get those kind of mindsets that they can do anything, say anything without any consequences. I don't care if it is the President of the United States. I don't care if it is the U.S. Supreme Court judge. I don't care who it is. Nobody should be above the law. But we have people trying to live above the law, paying others to live above the law. It's a whole lot of stuff going on. And because lawlessness abounds, because crime abounds, mm-hmm. because so much stuff is going on, the love of many gonna grow cold. How can you love a nation? How can you love people? How can you respect politicians? People who are in positions that could do something, to help the American people that could do something to stem the tide of violence, that could pass sensible gun legislation. There's some things they can do, but they sit back and all thing we hear is the blame game. Republicans won't do this. The Democrats won't do this. And while they are arguing and blaming one another, what? Lawlessness is getting worse. And so therefore the respect for one another is growing cold. Anytime people cannot be reeled in, anytime people don't want standards, anytime people can do whatever they want to do, guess what? Those people will not have love for one another. So he says, because lawlessness will abound, the love of many will grow cold. And how can you respect people when they just have no restrictions, no boundaries? How can you respect them? Okay? But Jesus said, but out of all of this that is going on, even right now, he who endures to the end shall be saved. He who remains faithful, he who walks right, talks right, he who does not allow the culture to suck him or her into this giant suction tube, that they start acting and living like the culture. That's something that my father always taught me. Just because someone else is doing it, don't mean you got to do it. Just because someone else is walking contrary to God, you don't have to do it. It comes a point where we have to let people go. It comes a point where we have to say to people, say to groups, it's not worth my life and my soul to continue to travel this path with you. If you want to travel a path of destruction, if you want to travel a path that works at cross purposes with the will of God, go ahead. I'm not going to do it because my soul is so expensive to me that I'm not going to let my desire to be friends with you, my desire to be in the in group, I'm not going to allow that to take away me trying to walk the narrow way. So if I have to be about myself, if I have to travel this road alone, I will do that because I'm not going to be sucked into someone else's ungodly standards. I'm not going to go along just to get along with other people. And here's what Jesus says. And this gospel of the kingdom, that's what you and I ought to be preaching, teaching, and living. The gospel of the kingdom. Jesus started his ministry off talking about the kingdom. And throughout his life, he was preaching and teaching about the kingdom. He was giving parables about the kingdom. And here he is again talking about the gospel of the kingdom. When the gospel of the kingdom will be preached in all the world as a witness to all nations, and then the end will come. So there are pockets of places on planet Earth where the gospel of the kingdom mm-hmm. has not yet been preached. So that means that out of all the satellites, out of all of the technology that we have, there are still places where the gospel has not yet been preached as a witness. But when it is, and what is it? Didn't say people won't be saved. It just says when it will be preached in the world as a witness to all nations. Didn't say when all nations accept the gospel of the kingdom. It says as a witness to all nations. See, then the end will come. Just because we preaching it, just because we teaching it, that doesn't mean that people are going to accept it. But at least when we preach it and teach it, then that means that we are putting it out there so that people will be without excuse. But just because we're preaching and teaching it does not mean that people are going to accept it. You got some people in the church don't even accept it. We got people in the postmodern church that won't accept the gospel of the kingdom. They're going to accept everything else. They're going to accept worldly standards. They're going to accept what the world says. But will they accept what Christ says? Because Christ's kingdom is coming to crush all other kingdoms. Mm-hmm. So therefore, the church, you and I, the body of Christ, we ought to be standing, preaching, witnessing, living out the gospel of the kingdom and preaching it as a witness to the world, to all nations. He said, once that happens, then the end will come. So we need to be intentional about remaining faithful. That does not mean that the enemy still won't come and try to deceive us. The enemy won't come and try to cause us grief. The enemy is going to come and do everything in his powers to knock us off that narrow path that you and I are traveling. He's going to try to bring fame, fortune, everything, materialism, position, power, anything he can bring you to tempt you to get off that narrow path. Because he knows that this world and everything in it will be destroyed. And this is why Jesus kept telling even the rich people, don't rejoice in your richness. These things are going to perish. What does it profit a man to gain the whole world and lose his soul? You can't take it with you. It's going to what? It's going to dissolve. It's going to be destroyed. So if we are coveting or hovering or trying to hold on to that which will be destroyed, you are having an exercise in futility. Mm-hmm. As much as we love our old cars, it comes a time when you just got to give it up. Mm-hmm. You got to give it up. Whether you didn't had it 20, 30 years, you got to give it up. Mm-hmm. You can't hold on to stuff. Mm-hmm. A house, you do our best to maintain it, but after a process of time, you got to do something to it. You're going to have to either tear it down, you're going to have to renovate it, you got to do something, because the materials that we use with cars and homes and whatever, those things are part of this world, and the materials of this world will fade away. Mm-hmm. Okay?
Amen.
All right, let's move on. Mm. All right. Now we're going to get into a discussion. And we're going to talk about in what ways can we learn to listen to the voice of God and not be distracted by deceiving spirits. See, because I want people to understand deceiving spirits speak too. Deceiving spirits can point out things to you too. So when people tell me, well, God told me to do that, and if God told you to do something and it's disrespectful, it's out of order, and it doesn't line up with scripture, and it's making you just want to be seen and all that's that, listen, that's a deceiving spirit. Deceiving spirits can talk. And if what he tells you gonna cause a whole lot of confusion, God is not the author of confusion. So in what ways can we learn to listen to the voice of God and not be distracted by deceiving spirits? Because there are many deceiving spirits out there. And what those deceiving spirits will do is tell you everything contrary to what God told you. It's no different than what the enemy told Eve. Did God say for you not to eat it? Oh, he didn't really mean that. You can go and do it. So everything that God tells us not to do, there are deceiving spirits out there to tell you, it's okay. God understands. He knows your heart. Hmm. All right, y'all talk to me. Put in the chat. In what ways can we learn to listen to the voice of God? And I was listening, not only listen to the voice of God, but obey the voice of God and not be distracted by deceiving spirits. They are there. They're even in the church. Even Jesus said, when the truth is told, the enemy is waiting to snatch it from you. So you can hear a teaching, you can hear a sermon in the church. By the time you leave the church and get to the parking lot, that deceiving spirit has already come. And before you know it, you're having a meeting in the parking lot. Did you hear what the pastor said? The devil is well right there waiting to snatch it from you, because he does not want you. He does not want you to embrace and live by and obey God's word, because he knows that that's going to bring you spiritual blessings. All right, y'all talk to me. I'm gonna give you a few minutes. I was talking while y'all, hopefully y'all was right. In what ways can we learn to listen to the voice of God? Listen to the voice of God. All right.
Okay, we have one. When someone tells you something that you feel is contrary to what God wants, check the Bible to verify. And I would add that the practice of being in Bible study and Sunday school and coming to hear the word and not allowing people to discourage you by saying negative things to you.
Amen. Amen. I think I saw another one come in.
That was the one. That was the last one.
Oh, okay. Amen. Well, what you have said is right on target. Right on target. You have to know God's word to be able to tell others. No, I'm going to have to check that. I'm going to have to verify that. There's nothing wrong in confirming some things. Don't just take what people say. Always say, you know what? I'll get back with you. I need to confirm some things. All right, we're going to go into our next scripture, and that's going to be read by Sister Toree Kapler, Matthew 24, 36 through 44.
Good evening, everybody. Can you all hear me?
Yes, ma'am.
I'm reading Matthew 24, 36, 44. But of that day and hour, no one knows, not even the angels of heaven, but my Father only. But as the days of Noah were, so also will the coming of the Son of Man be. For as in the days before the flood, they were eating and drinking, marrying and giving in marriage, until the day that Noah entered the ark and did not know until the flood came and took them all away. So also will the coming of the Son of Man be. Then two men will be in the field. One will be taken and the other left. Two women will be grinding at the mill. One will be taken and the other left. Watch therefore, for you do not know what hour your Lord is coming. But know this, that if the master of the house had known what hour the thief would come, he would be watched. He would have watched and not allowed his house to be broken into. Therefore, you also be ready, for the Son of Man is coming at an hour you do not expect.
Amen. Thank you, Sister Kapler, for reading us this scripture. And this, Jesus is talking about expectation. You need to expect that I'm coming. All right? Even though you have an expectation I'm coming, but you don't know exactly when I'm coming. So he's saying, be ready. Because I could come at any time, okay? Now, he says that, as we said before, no one knows. I cannot tell you it's going to be this year, this date, or this time. I can't tell you that. Only my Father knows when. But he says, as the days of Noah were, also will be the coming of the Son of Man. But as in the days before the flood, they were doing what? Eating and drinking and marrying and giving in marriage. Until the day that Noah entered the ark and did not know until the flood came and took them all away, so also shall be the coming of the man be. Well, what was going on in Noah's time? What was happening? Well, stuff that's going on right now. Everything was that man could think of, it was evil. Everything he could conjure up in his mind was evil, and evil continuously. Okay? That was widespread violence. Look at the violence in our culture today. Look at the violence and the lawlessness that's going on in our land today. Talk, everybody is on the edge. If you go shopping now, you know you're on the edge because you don't know if somebody's gonna start shooting. Violence, lawlessness, no respect for life. Okay. All these things were going on. And as they were happening in Noah's time, they are happening in our time. They may not have had AK-47s, but they had a way of disrespecting humanity. They had a way of fighting, committing crimes, and killing each other. They had a way of marrying and giving in marriage and everyday life. They had no forethought. They had no consideration that what Noah was trying to tell them would actually happen. See, God always sends a warning before destruction because he does not want to move in on people and they not be aware. So it is said that Noah preached 120 years. Y'all, it's going to rain. He preached 120 years, just like the day it all goes in one ear and come out another ear. Oh, that didn't happen today. This man don't know what he's talking about. So what they did every day, they just did not even consider that something could happen. They didn't even let it come through their thought processes. The only thing they thought about was walking in their own flesh. They only thought about satisfying their own flesh. They only thought about evil and evil continuously. Mm-hmm. Everything, widespread violence that was going on, okay? So Jesus talking about perilous time, you know, that he did not spare. Even it talks about how Noah was righteous. So that means that everybody that was not in Noah's family was considered unrighteous. But I can tell you what they were probably pushing for. They were probably pushing for the right to do this. We got a right to do this. We got a right to do that. I want to have the rights to do it. So just like I said, people want rights, but they don't want to live righteous. All of that was going on. And as I've already mentioned, all of the violence, everything that comes out of the heart, everything, even back in Noah times, evil thoughts, murderers, adultery, fornication, theft, false witnesses, blaspheming, Even presidents would lie out of their mouths. Can't answer a simple question. Just go all over creation and back. Just lying, going, and coming. That's what's going on today. You know, they lie themselves in the potato chip bag and lie themselves out of it. I mean, it's just a lie on top of lies. All that kind of stuff going on. There was no respect for one another. There was no respect for humanity. There was no respect for children, no respect for parents, no respect for teachers, no respect for boundaries. All of the stuff that was going on, everything that we can think of in our country, in our culture, that is diametrically opposed to the will of God, that was going on in Noah's time. It was going on in Noah's time. And they went about their merry way, didn't have a care in the world, other than what they wanted. And it says that while they were eating and drinking, look at all how food is advertised and teases an appetite in our going and coming. Look, food is everywhere. Fast food this, fast food that, all on the internet, TikTok, all this stuff. Food is everywhere. People were eating and drinking, marrying and giving in marrying, acting a fool, just like they did back in the time of Noah, folk acting a fool today. Okay, and then it says, but when the flood came, they were doing all this until the flood came and took them all away. And Jesus says, just like they were unsuspecting that something like this would happen, Jesus said, people are going to be unsuspecting today. The very time you think he's not going to come, that's the time he might come. And he said that two women are going to be grinding at the mill. One is going to be what? Taken and the other left. Well, why going to take one? Because one has her mind on Christ. One has her mind on being faithful. The other one could care less. So he gonna take one, he gonna leave the other. One gonna be in the field. All right? One taken and the other one left. Why? Because the one in the field gonna be thinking, being faithful to Christ, doing the things of Christ, and the other one had no care in the world. He could care less. All right? So he's telling us, when you see these things, when you witness these things, he says what? You know that something is about to happen. You know that these things are near. Therefore, he says, watch, for you don't know what hour your Lord is coming. You know, just like my parents. And my father told us to do certain things when I was coming up. We would wait until we see the car leave. And boy, he said, don't go outside. Don't you go outside. But we wait till that car leave and we get outside and get with the other young folk in the community. But somebody was watching. And one time we was out there playing basketball. And we got so engrossed in the game, by the time somebody watched, the car was already at home. I said, oh, Lord have mercy. It was already at home. So all four of his sons, he said, come on in. Because my dad always talked about, I'm going to bust you. That's what he said. I'm going to bust the water out of you. So we all got a whipping. We got a good whipping because he told us not to do it. Because we said, well, which one of y'all didn't watch? Ones were supposed to be watching to make sure that we say, hey, man, here he come, because he could top the hill. We could see him, and we all could get home in time before he parks the car. But the watchman got in what? He got engrossed in the game, and he got to watch. And by the time he became conscious, the car was already there. Jesus is saying, I want you to watch, therefore, because you don't know when I'm coming. You don't know when I'm coming, but know this, that if the master of the house had known what hour the thief would come, he would not have watched. He would have watched and not allow his house to be broken into. If somebody told you, y'all better watch your house because, you know, it's a thief around here, you would what? You'd be a little bit more careful. If a person came to a church and you know that he was convicted because he what? He steals stuff. He's considered a thief. Wouldn't that make you a little more conscious? You'd be grabbing them purses. You'd be grabbing everything. Because what? Just the reputation of the person comes in among you that causes you to take what? Extra precaution and extra protection of your possessions. So Jesus is saying to us, I want you to watch. Therefore, be ready, for the Son of Man is coming at an hour you do not expect. And that can come at a drop of a pen. Well, I thought you were coming at the night. I didn't tell you I was coming at the night. I told you to be ready. I told you to be ready. And this is why I say he's going to come and he's going to catch the postmodern church, not on his job. He's going to catch the postmodern church going along with the crowd, going along with culture, doing things that the kingdom told us not to do, embracing things the kingdom told us not to embrace. He's going to catch us. And that's what I said on Sunday in my sermon. He's not going to Washington State. He already knows the government. He already knows the world. But he's coming first, according to the scripture. He's coming first to the house of prayer. And that's where judgment going to start. That's where it's going to start, with us, the house of prayer. And if we are living outside of his will, if we're doing things with no relationship with Christ, if we are out of fellowship with one another, if we're allowing certain things to go on in the house as they did in Jesus' time when they were selling and giving in, stuff like Jesus ran them out. You don't let me come and catch you living outside my will. Don't come and let me catch the postmodern church doing things it should not be doing, because you know, Jesus did say in Revelation, I'm going to remove you out of your candlestick. I'm going to remove your candlestick. In other words, God will punish the church, and the church can be lost because what? Of disobedience. All right, let's move on. Let's move on. I believe that's it. Amen. The time is drawing near. All right, let me hear just a little bit of that. Then we're going to go and pray.
Can't you see the end of time is drawing nigh? Can't you see the end of time is drawing nigh?
Amen.
I see the signs on the land, destruction in the sky. That's why I know the end of time is drawing nigh. The disciples came to Jesus. They said, how will we know when the Son of Man will come again? Jesus told them the signs, and some of them are happening now. That's how I know the end of time is drawing nigh. Church, can't you see the end of time is drawing nigh? Can't you see the end of time is drawing nigh? I see the signs on the land, destruction in the sky. That's how I know the end of time is drawing nigh. Men are lovers of themselves, covetous and boasters too, proud, blasphemers, disobedient to their parents too, unthankful, unholy, and this is the reason why. I can see the end of time is drawing nigh. Can't you see the end of time is drawing nigh? Can't you see the end of time is drawing nigh? I see the signs on the land, destruction in the sky, and I know the end of time is drawing nigh.
Amen. Amen. We can see that the time is growing now. Amen. It's getting closer. Mm-hmm. And I tell people all the time, you know, you're going to be without excuse, because church, sometimes we love big gatherings, we love concerts, and all that's fine and well, but comes a time you have to sit under the word of God. You have to be instructed in the word of God.
Wow.
In order to know the word of God. My people are destroyed for lack of knowledge. Mm. And if a church cannot come under the teaching, then it won't have the power to defeat its enemies. It won't have the power to sustain, to advance the kingdom of God. It's all about kingdom, people. Mm. Yes, we got a history. Yes, First Baptist has it. But understand this. It's all about God's kingdom, okay? Every church got to hear, but it's about God's kingdom. Everything we do is wonderful, but still we need to learn about the kingdom, because Christ says that when the gospel is preached, all right, in every nation, then shall the end come. It's Amen. About kingdom. We need to learn about kingdom. We need to walk in kingdom. And we need to communicate kingdom. Amen. Amen. Let us pray. Father God, we just want to thank you for this time together.
Yes.
We want to thank you, Lord, for the signs that we see.
Mm.
And we know, Lord, that your coming is near. We don't know the exact time. We don't know the exact date or the exact year. And Father, but we say, position us, Father, that we will remain faithful.
Yes.
And even if you come and get us, before the consummation of the whole world, we want to be ready whenever you come and get us individually. Help us to be faithful, Lord, when you call our names. Yes. We want, Lord, to be allowing our light to shine. We want to be in a position, Lord, where we are allowing you to get the glory in and through our lives. Father, I pray that you would help the postmodern church to prioritize, because you told us to put the kingdom first. And all these other things will be added unto us. And so, Father, help us to put the kingdom first. Lord, we know we have sick among us. Yes. We know we have some people who need to be delivered among us. Yes. We know, Father, we have some people that need, Lord, to be released among us. And so, Father, we are praying that you touch each and every person from the crown of their head to the sole of their feet. We're praying for Reverend James and Connie Walker. We're praying, Lord, for Reverend James Ingram. We're praying for Sister Ann Parker. We're still praying, Lord, for Reverend Graham's family. We're still praying for Brother Tamar Hundley. Continue to touch his body.
Yes,
we're still praying for Sister Sheila Bartlett,
yes.
Sister Ruby Palmer.
Yes.
We're still praying for Sister Stacy Hill, Sister Jean Hunter, and her family. Lord, don't forget Sister Lauren Atkins, Sister Deborah Hawkins,
yes.
Sister Annette Banks, Brother and Sister Minnie Robinson, Sister yes. Peggy Randall. Father, we're still praying for Alvin Conyers, mm-hmm. Brother Mason Neal, Sister Monica Wells, my good friend, Reverend Roosevelt Knight, and his daughter, Anissa Holmes. Father, we're still praying for Brother Oliver Ruff, Sister Annie Mae Davis. We're still praying, Lord, for our young people, Lord, who are going to school.
Yes.
We pray, Father, that you bless these young people to finish strong.
Yes,
continue, Lord, to cover them with your Holy Spirit.
Yes,
continue to be with them in their travels and their going and comings.
Yes.
Father, then don't forget, Lord, Brother Oliver Ruff and my dear mother, Sister Annie Mae Davis. And Lord, don't forget my mother-in-law, Sister DeBrois. And Father, we just praying for all of the bereaved families and all of the body of Christ. And then don't forget Williamsburg Baptist Church. Mm-hmm. They received a bomb threat. And so, Father, we ask, Lord, that you would calm their fears and cover them with your Holy Spirit.
Yes.
Bring them, Lord, to a point where they'll say, Lord, you are our Lord.
Yes.
You are our Savior. And we're going to walk in the path of righteousness.
Mm-hmm.
And so, Father, we ask that you cover them, and not only them, but cover First Baptist and every church, Father, that's lifting up your name and lifting up your word. Now, at this time, Father, we're going to call the names of others that I didn't call, but we know, Father, that you hear us all. Let's call their names.
Stacy Hill.
Ruth Hill. Ruth Askew.
Baptist Church.
Gloria McIntyre.
The Hodge family.
From the Prado.
The Feast of
Barbara Harris.
Our pastors that we're very close with, all the churches. Our children, grandchildren.
Minnie Robinson.
Atkinson Williams,
Reverend
Quincy Davis,
Cameron family, Lacey,
Curtis Lassiter,
Hendricks.
Father, you have heard the names that we have called, and Lord, you even know the ones we have not called.
Yes.
Lord, we just ask that you touch,
Lord,
as only you know how. Because, Lord, when you touch, people are delivered. Yeah. When you touch, people are healed. When you touch, people are encouraged. When you touch, Father, people can stand up. When you touch, Father, people can go on a little while longer. So we're praying that you touch and that you deliver. And, Lord, we're just praying that you cover us, go before us, come behind us, be over us and under us. Because,
mm-hmm.
Father, we need your protection in this violent field, land, and society in which we live. We need your protection. We yes. plead the blood of Jesus.
In the name of Jesus.
Lord, we plead it in our homes. We plead yes. it over our children and yes. our grandchildren. Yes. We plead it over our congregations, Father.
Yes.
Lord, we know, Lord, that all Lord, we got to do is continue to call your name and
yes.
trust in your word.
Yes, Father.
And Father, we know that you can speak that word.
Yes.
And the enemies will flee. They come in one way, Lord, but you can scatter them seven ways.
Yes, Lord.
So keep us.
Thank you.
And keep your people, not only here in America,
yes.
but all over the world.
Yes, Lord.
And Lord, hopefully one day we'll be able to behold your face and hear those assuring words to our souls. Servants, well done.
Mm-hmm.
You've been faithful for over few things. Come
yes.
and I'll make you ruler over much. So we're looking for that day, Father.
Mm-hmm.
Lord, when you will move back the curtain.
Yes.
And there won't be no more separation between heaven and earth. We can see you as you are.
Yes.
These and all blessings we ask in our son Jesus' name. And the people of God said, amen.
Amen.
Amen. Amen. Amen. Amen. Amen. Amen. Amen.